What's going on, guys? Arav here. Welcome back to the Pit Lane Podcast, episode number 24. It has been a while, about 3-4 weeks. Obviously, we took a summer break, as did Real Life Formula One. We're back for the Belgian Grand Prix review. I need to say also before, the format's changed a little bit. We're not going to have moving pictures no longer at the bottom, because if you actually noticed on the channel, our Austrian Grand Prix, was it Austrian or what was it? The German Grand Prix? I can't even remember. I think it was Austrian.
I think Austria.
The Austria podcast got taken down by FOM. Because I don't think they like the title. I think I titled it like a... I titled one of the podcasts like it was a boring Grand Prix. And I don't think FOM quite liked it being one of the top search results and coming up as this Grand Prix was boring. So they used the fact that I had pictures of the Grand Prix to take it down. Otherwise, they had no grounds to take it down. But they used the pictures as a way to take it down. So we'll no longer have pictures in. Just so if they do then take it down, it is going to be complete bullshit if they do. So
wasn't it Baku or Hungary? Because if it's, Austria was an incredible race.
Yeah, no, it wasn't boring. Like it. It was one of... I think it might have been Baku, maybe, or Hungary. I think it was Hungary.
It's one of those
two. I think it was Hungary. But anyway, yeah. So that's why there can be no longer any moving pictures. So FOM, if you take this one down or any future ones, you have no grounds and just, yeah, as Tom as Tom rightly says, just, you know, F you. But yeah, anyway, we're going to move on with the Belgium Grand Prix. Obviously, quite a mad first 12 laps-ish. First 8 laps was mental for everyone on Twitter, especially going absolutely bonkers at what happened at the start. I think the best way we'll do it is just go team by team, and that's a good way to kind of structure it. Otherwise, we'll get kind of lost in trying to keep up with everything that happened in that race. So we'll start off with Mercedes. Obviously, Nico Rosberg ended up winning the Grand Prix, and Hamilton, surprisingly, with a third place after starting from the back. But obviously, Hamilton helped a lot by the start. He got a pretty clean-ish getaway, kind of navigating through the cars. And Rosberg didn't really have any issues that I know of, that I can recall. So pretty bog-standard race for him and really Hamilton, apart from maybe a weird strategy.
Nico had just, you know, standard start, no problems. He went alone into turn one. You know, he didn't have to go side by side with anybody, and he just drove his own race. Pretty boring from his point of view, but I mean,
everything happened behind him.
Yeah, exactly.
Everything happened behind him at turn one, very closely behind him, should we say. We'll get into that in a moment. But yeah, Rosberg just drove the perfect race, the best he could have done. He knew Hamilton was going to have the end of the grid penalty, so all he could do for the championship is just win the race and hope that Hamilton had a bit of a worse result than what he did get, but Hamilton came through in P3, solid job, did what he had to do, had the car underneath him, did the right strategy call. Bit of a dodgy call coming in for softs again and then going on to mediums for the last 15 laps or something like that. I thought he could have just gone medium straight to the end and saved himself to stop, and then maybe he would have finished poorly in P2 ahead of Ricciardo, but obviously Mercedes, they're known for not being the brightest bulbs in the universe when it comes to strategy. So I think
maybe
they might have got that one a little bit
wrong. I mean, they always say they've checked the numbers anyway. So I guess for them, they felt that was the better strategy for them. But even Lewis,
the numbers,
even
so Lewis, that must mean it's right.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, even Lewis questioned it at the time on the radio. But apart from that, actually quite a normal bog standard race for Mercedes. You know, Hamilton got through fine, no issues there, so really standing for them. Red Bull, if we go down to the next team, Ricciardo in second place. Not such a straightforward race for them in terms of Max Verstappen, who came in 11th place after a brilliant front row start. But obviously at turn one, things happened, and then throughout the race, things happened. So, Tom, Justin, you want to take us through the start, opinions on that? I think, Tom, you said your opinion changed after seeing a proper replay of all the onboards, so... At the start, initially, it looked like maybe Verstappen tried something a bit too much into turn one, but then it turned out Vettel and, well, it was mainly Vettel, squeezing Raikkonen towards the wall or towards the apex and not realising there was a third car there.
Well, at first sight, I thought Verstappen just went for a bit of an audacious dive back up the inside to try and hold on to P2 on super softs, but that was my first reaction. But then when I saw it back, Vettel really just didn't... Apparently he said... I just read before the podcast started, it was like Raikkonen was on his blind spot or something, so you couldn't see him.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So he basically just turned in and maybe put Raikkonen in a bit of a sandwich. But that sort of really just dampened Ferrari's race, that Vettel's incident there. And both him and Raikkonen had to fight back for the field. And, 6th and 9th. Not a bad result for Ferrari. So, yeah, I mean, they showed more promise over the weekend. I thought they could have got a bit more out of it, but you know, turn one happened. So.
Yeah, I definitely think they could have got more out of it, because also Kimi with going round on the lap with his car scraping the ground, obviously his, the plank caught fire, and then they had a very slow pit stop there. Obviously, it kind of didn't matter because the race got neutralized with the safety car, but if it hadn't come out, so Kimi actually got quite lucky there, because if it hadn't come out, mm-hmm. his race was really in tatters, being mm-hmm. so far behind with that such a slow pit stop. It was almost like, I think the mechanics couldn't get to the front wing adjustment they were trying to do because of the fire, and they were getting a little bit scared of it, so they had to get the extinguisher out and everything like that, faff around with it. But some okay pace from Ferrari, so I'm disappointed that I think they could have got a lot better result, because they look pretty decent on the straights, apart from maybe against the Williams car. But apart from that, they're trying to fly past. Obviously, Raikkonen and Verstappen had their versus battle, and there's many, many different opinions on that, which we'll maybe get to a little bit later, because otherwise I think we could go on for a while. So getting back to what we started off with Red Bull, Ricciardo, solid race. Obviously, he was quite disappointed probably not be able to do better in qualifying, you know, being beaten by Max for second place there and being behind both Ferraris. So I think Ricciardo, he went into the weekend saying, I want to get another podium, and he's done just that. And it's second place, not third, behind another car. So I think he'll be pretty chuffed with that. Yeah. And obviously, we had that amazing moment on the podium where he got Mark Webber.
That was his highlight of the race. That was his highlight of the race. That was brilliant. Yeah,
that was a class podium. Class podium. We need more Mark Webber on the podium. He is a great, great person to have on the podium, because he
Arnold Schwarzenegger, they are the two best podium interviewers of all time.
I feel like, as Mark's an ex-driver, he can just get a bit more banter out of them on the podium as well, and just kind of relate with them a bit more. But yeah, pretty awesome race for Ricciardo there. And Verstappen, yeah, I mean, after the race, there were a few little interesting snippets from what he had to said. A lot of the time, basically the gist of it was, he's been saying, yeah, my moves are aggressive, but they have to deal with it. Which
Hashtag deal with it.
Is a very, I guess that's maybe his age coming into it, maybe a kind of immature way to look at it, like deal with it, like, okay, you can't really just say just deal
need,
with
need
it.
The glasses to come from up here.
When Verstappen came in, everybody said, you know, he's much more mature than you would think based on his age, and I think his recent actions are kind of going against that. I don't know if he thought maybe he built up some sort of like moral bank balance, and now he can just withdraw from that or something like that. But
that's a good way to put it.
he's going against the way, you know, people thought the world of him when he first came in, and now it's starting to decline. I mean, I'm sure you guys have noticed there's been several tweets. I didn't make any of them, but there's been several tweets comparing Max Verstappen to Pastor Maldonado. Like, just because you're a race winner, you know, Pastor was a race winner too, man. So, you know, you're really not helping things here.
I was going to say, if you get a chance,
disclaimer,
get a chance,
we did not make any
worth.
Of the tweets. We did not make any of the tweets. If you want to send it to @AFNino on Twitter.
Yeah.
I was gonna say, I think it might be worth it if you do remember to do this in the post edit. Just stick the tweet, the, you know, Joe's tweet. Just stick underneath.
I'll stick that tweet and Nino's tweet, and you can go send them some tweets if you want to. But we didn't make any comparisons. I was too busy tweeting about Felipe Massa's dad, which we'll get to in a second.
Ditto. Same here.
This race was a mad one. The first eight laps, then like became a bog standard race. But the banter was amazing from the entire race. Just what happened on Twitter. You really did miss out if you weren't on Twitter for it. But so that was Red Bull's race. We'll get more into the kind of Verstappen debate a little bit more after we've done all the teams, because I feel like that'll be something we can talk about a bit more. We talked about Ferrari. There's not actually too much else to talk about. Obviously, Kimi is part of that Verstappen debate. But Vettel had a very kind of just a standard race trying to get back into it after that Turn 1 incident. Then we move on to, surprisingly, Force India is the next team.
I was going
to
say about Ferrari.
Yeah.
They are under massive pressure for the next race in Monza. Huge pressure to deliver. They have to deliver something. Apparently, there was like, I read during the week, they've got like a massive engine upgrade ready that they were going to bring for this race, but they've decided to push it back for Monza.
Right.
So
just to make sure it's all ready to go.
Yeah. But they need to get a result.
They surely have
to be a double podium at least.
I was going to say surely just a podium, but
at least one podium.
Yeah, at least like. I don't even think a third would cut. I think they need to get second, at least, to like try and get something back for like their fans and everything. Because lately, it's almost like I really do hope they really have gone full 2017 mode. Because at this rate, I really hope they're not trying to push this car anymore, because they're really not getting anywhere too much. And they just keep also tripping over, like, the drivers. Well, obviously, you get some bad luck here and there, but both the drivers are getting
second time this season.
Really, like, it's the second poor time luck, just tripping over people in some other sense. But moving on to the next team, surprisingly, Force India, who climb above Williams and the Constructors now. Nico Hülkenberg in fourth place, Sergio Perez in fifth. A brilliant race for them. And, I mean, they just did a really solid job. Hülkenberg at the start did really well to get there and was fighting for what was third place. Eventually, obviously, the pace just shone through of the other cars to come back through. But, really, nothing really went wrong for Force India. They just did the best they could. And I think Justin, you were saying Perez at the interview was basically like, you know, that was the best we could probably hope for there.
Right, yeah. I mean, they're ahead of Williams now. But, yeah, Sergio was saying in an interview with, I think it was Simon Lazenby, that, you know, probably getting any staying in fourth is probably going to be very difficult, to be totally honest, especially if they're switching focus towards 2017. But, you know, it's obviously a good sign. It's a track that Force India in general tends to go well at, actually, is Spa.
Yeah, yeah.
Obviously, they had Kamui Kobayashi on the front row in 2012. They had Giancarlo Fisichella getting pole or whatever it was back in the day. So it really seems like Spa's just, you know, a circuit that Force India has always really gone well at. And that showed today. And, you know, if it wasn't for the red flag and all of that stuff, Hülkenberg may have actually held on to third, because all that stuff allowed Hamilton to just come through the field even quicker than he would have done. So if it wasn't for all of that, I think Hülkenberg may have picked up his first podium possibly today. But fourth and fifth is you know, that's a hell of a lot of points. That's 22 points. So
for a team like Force India, that's amazing.
And Sergio was way down in ninth or something on lap one, because he had to go around the Vettel Raikkonen Verstappen incident, and I think Jensen did as well, which caused them to lose. Yeah, they lost a lot of positions as a result of that. So all things considered, I think they should be very happy with fourth and fifth.
Yeah.
Double check. You said Kamui Kobayashi in the front row in 2012.
Yeah, wasn't it?
It was in the Sauber.
I don't think Kobayashi drove.
Oh, that's right. yep. Slight mistake there.
Slight mistake. really, really solid race for Force India. And especially because, I don't know, lately, like last few races, like, correct me if I'm wrong, I feel like they haven't been even on the TV too much as of late, like, just haven't been getting much TV action time. So it's nice to see them, like, right up there, back in the kind of focus of the race, genuinely being there for third and, like, having to try and fight off the faster car. But obviously, as you said, Hamilton helped out quite a lot. So obviously, Vettel finished sixth and Raikkonen was ninth. So we talked about Ferrari there. Alonso, seventh place. Jensen Button crashed out the race by Pasco Wehrlein, which was a great one, Pascal. Really good. Just straight in the back of him.
Weird, right? How he just really drove right into the back of him? It was really weird.
Jensen went deep into the corner, but he's literally right there. You can see his car, and he just accelerated into him.
Right into the back of him.
Yeah, so that was a shame. You could tell Pascal was also annoyed with himself, because I feel like him and Ocon could have done a good job. Ocon came in 16th, but you just never know if he was still in the race. Maybe something else would happen, having one extra car there in the mix, and you just never know what would happen. So he felt like on the shot when he was walking through the pen, he looked pretty disappointed with it, and as he should be.
Yeah.
But yeah, Alonso,
I got the impression when Wehrlein went to the back of Button, I thought Button swung out a bit unexpectedly. He swung right out, because you could see Wehrlein was going to try
cut
back underneath him. And then I think he swung out too much, and I think he misjudged it, and he went underneath him. But I still don't think I was expecting more from them. Obviously, we don't know how Wehrlein would have done, but I thought they would have been a bit more higher up, but you know.
I assume Wehrlein would have been ahead of Ocon. Because he seemed quicker all week. I mean, this is Esteban's first F1 race ever.
Yeah,
so
I mean, he's still going to get used to the car, but he did it to, like, fair play to him. Like, he looked pretty comfy in the car anyway for being his very first time in it. But Alonso, seventh place, I think pretty damn decent considering it is Spa, a very long back straight, also up the Kemmel straight, up Eau Rouge. I think Alonso did a fantastic job to try and fight people. He tried his best to kind of hold off people behind him, fight the likes of the Williams, the Force Indias, and he did pretty well to get a well-earned six points, especially if you consider he was literally at the very back of the grid with Hamilton. did really well. Yep. I think he got him into, what was it, 10th place on like the first two laps or something like that. And then by the time the safety car came out, he was up in what was 6th, and then he became 5th.
No, he was 4th at one point.
Yeah, 4th. Yeah, it was Hamilton 5th.
Unbelievable.
They were both 5th and 6th, and someone pit, and then they got up to, he got up to 4th. So, yeah, I think it's all things considered, a fantastic race from him, and I think he could be should be pretty happy with that. I mean, obviously, being Alonso, he's not going to be majorly satisfied with 7th still, but considering the situation he's in, I think he can really pat himself on
that. Beat his teammate, so I think he'd be happy with that as well. I mean, to be honest with you, I'm not saying that's a jab. I mean, genuinely, he beat his team. I know Button crashed out, but what I'm saying is he's the one, the only car to finish. So that's obviously going to be great. He'll be happy with that. But I think I'd put him probably over. I'd probably put him as my driver of the day, even ahead of Hamilton. Even though Hamilton did the exact same thing all the way up to third place, I think Hamilton has better tools for that. Whereas Alonso, around a track that, you know, is going to be a tough track for the McLaren Honda. He did a great job today, I think, you know, and really keeping the Williams behind him. That was also really good defensive driving from him.
Yeah, yeah. I think he also used the fact that both Williams cars, they're on medium tyres at the end, weren't they, as well? And I think they're
all on the same tyres.
Yeah, they're all on the same tyres. But I think the Williams cars were struggling a little bit, because you can see Massa dropped off the pace, because he was ahead of Bottas and Kimi, then dropped behind both of them. And that, I guess that moves us on to Williams. So Bottas, I feel like he did quite a quiet race. Like, I didn't really see much of him, actually. I saw a lot of Massa. Massa was getting a lot of fights. Obviously, we saw that brilliant moment where the person who does like the camera switching for F1 really needs to get paid a decent bonus today.
They need a bonus,
because it was the best hard cut I've ever seen of Massa being overtaken and squeezed out, and
That will be down there. If you're gonna put that down there,
I'll put
the
picture down there because F1 can't copyright that. Literally, the best hard cut after he got squeezed out, hard cut to Massa's dad, and he basically just had the biggest death stare ever. Of like, I am not impressed. Not impressed.
I think the realization is settled in there that his son's not good enough anymore.
Someone was tweeting me like quotes of what Massa's dad was thinking. He's like, "That's not my son. He's useless. That can't be my son." That was just a golden moment in the race.
Probably I think we saw Massa's dad almost as much as we saw Massa, which was quite
a
bit.
Exactly. And then officially, he's literally already become a meme now in the F1 community on Twitter. It's absolutely brilliant. Massa's
hashtag
dad
Massa dad
doing the job. So that was great. And Williams, yet again, just having a bit more of a quiet race than they would have liked down in 8th and 10th. Again, just showing that they just seem to be kind of lagging and just kind of stagnating, you know, a little bit.
Speaking of teams that we hope has turned focus towards 2017 is Williams. I mean, I'm a Force India fan. I don't know if you could tell. But, you know, I genuinely feel for Williams. You know, they finally got back in 2014 to where you would expect Williams to be, to be totally honest. And then now they're just slipping back down. And I genuinely feel bad, even though, you know, my favorite team just overtook them. I'm like, come on, guys. Like, you're better than this. You should really be performing better. So I'm hoping it's because they've, you know, stopped development on this car.
I completely agree with that. I really do hope they are.
I don't. I think we've spoken about it before. They think they're a big team, but...
Well, you know, that's also a thing. Like, no, but at the same time, I do hope that that's the case then. But also at the same time, I do also have this same point with Tom, that at the same time, I still feel like in every single interview you see with, like, Claire Williams or something, they still feel like they're, like, legitimately there at the top fighting, where it's like, no, you really are basically a midfield team. You're best of the rest. It's like Williams and Force India maybe level pegging, McLaren just slowly trying to get in the mix there, and then you've got the other teams, which are the solid midfield, and then the back markers, really. So...
Someone should get one of those graphs from F1 2016 shows you the level of everyone.
Yeah,
and someone
comparison
should just do a real version of that. Of the real F1 teams.
And then outside the points, obviously, we had Max Verstappen 11th. And then getting on to the other teams, Esteban Gutierrez in 12th. From obviously, he was the one. He was the Haas with the grid penalty, right? He had impeded someone in FP3.
Yes. Yeah, I watched it live. Honestly, I know they were saying it's a radio miscommunication, but... You can't do that, man. That, like, that could have been a horrible crash. I don't know if you've seen it, Arif, but Justin, have you seen it?
I don't think I saw it live. I don't know. Was it during qualifying or a practice session?
Yeah,
it was in FP3.
Yeah, I didn't see
it. Verstappen was coming up through Eau Rouge at full speed on a lap. And Gutierrez slowed down. He was going slow, but he was right in the middle of the track. So Verstappen, you know, through the little right-hand kink when you're going onto the Kemmel Straight, he had to go on the grass.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's dangerous stuff. So, yeah, I mean, that sounds penalty worthy. Certainly, I didn't see it, but I mean, that's one of the worst places on the calendar to have a mistake, is at the top of Eau Rouge, just before the Kemmel Strait, you know, just after Rabion.
You're going over the crest blind. You just, yeah, those
And
speeds,
you're going
you
so
don't
fast.
Have much
yeah.
Time. Yeah. So, yeah, yeah. I think he did pretty well to get back into 12 from the low position he had. Obviously, again, as many people did, he got an advantage off the start with everything going quite crazy indeed. Mm-hmm. And also, Grosjean did really well. He was, like, right up there.
They were both in the points at one point in the race.
At one point, Grosjean was, like, up in fifth, like, looking really good. And then, I guess, just the pace started to come in, finally.
Yep.
They just started to fall back, unfortunately. But 12th and 13th, but again, Gutierrez finishing ahead of Grosjean. So, I feel like, from the start of the season where Grosjean was really on top of him, I think they're starting to come back as, like, a fair fight, really.
And then we had certainly closer
Daniel Kvyat in 14th place. Carlos Sainz obviously had that very weird crash that looked pretty damn funny.
Yeah.
Where his rear tire got like a thread of the rear tire like got chucked up and caught the rear wing and literally pulled the rear wing down towards the tire, and then he did like a really funny flip because he tried to get back around the track as fast as he could. Did a flip, then got off the grass, and then as he came towards the kind of understeery hairpin corner towards the corner with no name, he literally just the car just started tilting and like just didn't look like a car anymore.
No.
I don't even know. It reminded me of it was like Spider-Man shooting a spider where he shot one out the rear wheel, shot one out to the rear wing, like caught onto it and was trying to pull it down.
Yeah, it was literally like that. It's so weird. Like the thread just got like caught and just pulled it down. So Kvyat was the only Toro Rosso to finish in 14th place. Was looking okay at the start of the race, but then just slowly, as every news outlet talked about at the beginning of the Grand Prix race weekend, the Toro Rosso now, the engine is starting to show that. 2015 Ferrari engine is starting to show. Like it's now at the point where it looks like it definitely is slower than the Honda as well. So, I think Toro Rosso just have to try their best. I think it was Franz Tost said they have to keep developing the aero this year just to kind of offset the deficit they're getting from the engine. So, unfortunately, they may be hindered a little bit with 2017 in that aspect. But as I was saying to you guys before the podcast, surely with the new kind of built relationship with Red Bull and Renault, surely Toro Rosso will be kind of cushing up back to Renault to get an engine for next year with them.
You'd hope so.
I feel like,
I feel
like it'd be a kind of very clever move for them to kind of get back right in there. And then Renault, obviously, we haven't mentioned it yet, but it was a huge part of the race. Kevin Magnussen, an absolute huge shunt. That car was absolutely destroyed. The entire like half rear end was like slammed. That was the thing that impacted a lot of energy. The tire barrier completely chucked up, barrier broken in.
It reminded me of Alonso, Australia. You know when you just see the car and it's actually so destroyed?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like it's actually just toasted.
Yeah.
Yeah, like Crofty said,
that bad.
Crofty said, that's going to be a rebuild. And I was like, no, that's going to be a brand new car.
Yeah.
Like, literally, everything needs to be replaced.
That's not going to be a rebuild job. That's going to be like a. They're saying I was watching the Channel 4 commentary, they're saying that they're already struggling a little bit. They've heard rumors of, like, Renault not being able to get enough, like, carbon fiber bodies and everything fitted for the race chassis. So, and they're saying, well, this week, they're definitely going to have to really push hard to make sure everything's done and, like, they're not kind of using any kind of old parts or anything like that. And then, obviously, I think at the moment, as it stands, I think the reports of Magnussen had, like, a cut on his ankle.
Yeah.
Just a few little kind of bumps. Obviously, he looked shook after he got out of the crash because it's quite a hefty one. I think he also kind of the shoulder rests, the kind of on top of them kind of popped out of the car.
Hands device, is that what it's called?
The hands is the kind of headrest thing just got chucked out of the car. So I think he actually lifted up out of the car a little bit and then kind of sat back down. So he was a little bit winded, but it looks like he's going to be okay. We'll see if he actually passes medicals.
I've got a feeling that cut on his ankle could be a painful one because he was limping, getting out of the car with the adrenaline.
Yep.
Once that adrenaline wears off, he's going to be, that's going to be bruised up real nice. So he's going to be, apparently there's rumors going around that Ocon might actually go back into Renault for the next race for one race.
That's what I wanted to bring up.
Because he's more
contracted to Renault than he is to Manor.
Yeah. He's always had, because like in the preseason testing, not preseason, middle season testing, he was in a Renault, and then I think he did also a few laps in the Mercedes, but he never actually did it in like a Manor or anything like that.
He's got one week.
That's what I'm saying for the medical, to pass medical, there is a chance he's not even passed. And even if he is, it could be a case of that, he just can't do it if there's too much pain in his ankle.
Yep.
I think they'll be all right. They did it Thursday, didn't they? Thursday, I think they did it with Alonso at Bahrain.
Yeah.
So I think it should be okay, but it's not like Alonso where, with your ribs, it's like, the rib situation is a bit worse because it takes a very long time to recover, whereas your ankle is a bit more. You can take a whack on the ankle if you know.
Yeah, it
what
depends
I mean.
On also how yes. We don't know how bad the cut was that he got to his ankle or anything like that. Yeah. But yeah, very heavy shunt, but glad
depends
to see.
Depends on
okay.
The type of fracture if there is like a fracture, because like if it's a hairline fracture, then obviously that heals up pretty quickly.
Yeah, yeah,
whereas
yeah.
If something actually like split off, that's a little bit yeah. worse.
Oh,
so.
If something did split off, I don't think he would have been walking out of that car.
Yeah,
so
it looked like
I think
yeah,
it's alright.
Yeah, probably like a hairline one, as Justin said.
Right.
But
yeah.
Palmer in 15th place. At one point, the Renaults were doing really well. They're up in like the top 10. It was like, what on earth is going on here? But then obviously, you know, just the pace, the downforce they just don't have came into play, really. And I think Tom mentioned it. It was kind of a shame from last year, you know, Grosjean getting the third place to now in 15th. It's not a good situation, but Renault clearly just have to keep on working on getting a downforce. And 2017 being very heavily on aero for the new regs, we'll see how they fare. But another kind of just normal race for Renault, kind of really nice for them to be up there, but eventually they just fell back. And then Felipe Nasr finished up in 17th place. Ericsson retired in the kind of mayhem at the start of the race.
Did he get Ocon? Or did he finish behind Ocon?
Nasr finished behind Ocon in 17th. Right. Ocon finished 16th. So Sauber brought a brand new front wing that finally looked a little more complex. Mm-hmm. Apparently they've had it designed for quite a while, but it only took them till now for the new funding to come in so they could actually spend it and actually build it. But still a lot of work to do. Obviously one little front wing change is not going to do huge amounts to get you up the grid. So
especially at Spa, you know, if they were going to Singapore or something, then front wing might make a huge difference. But at Spa, it's really not
going
to do a whole.
Going to Singapore, I feel like they like it tracks like that. They'll be a bit more confident than they maybe might have been at those circuits with the new aero parts. But obviously, still plugging on. And I think Sauber is more of a long term kind of plan at this point. So I think for now they're just trying to chug along, perhaps trying to get an elusive point.
Yeah,
to try
they
and
need
help
it.
Them out. Yeah. But apart from that, that's really where the going through the teams ended. Felipe Nasr, 17th. So retirements were obviously Magnussen, Ericsson, Button, Sainz, and Wehrlein. Obviously, we talked about all of them and how they retired. So I guess the kind of, let's get onto the big talking points of the race. Obviously, Kimi v Verstappen and just Verstappen in general. Mentioned it a little bit about what he said after the race. As a whole, how did you just guys see all the action? You know, we had, obviously, it started off with Raikkonen. He tried to make a move around the outside. Pushed him off a little bit. They banged tyres. Raikkonen had to go across the little kind of sleeping policeman and come back on track. And then we had it again with Sergio Perez or Hülkenberg? I think it was one of the 14.
Yeah, Perez.
Wasn't it?
Perez at Perez. Lecum.
Yep. Just it was the same place mostly after the Kemmel Strait. Just
he gets the inside line heading into Lecum,
and then
he carries too much speed through it basically and forces them to go off the circuit. And, you know, it's one of those things where you can't outright tell him, like, no, that's wrong. You have to give the place back or, you know, like that sort of thing. He's not getting any friends. Nobody's going to respect him for doing stuff like that.
It's
as far as the other drivers, I mean, like other drivers are certainly not going to appreciate being pushed off the circuit.
Yeah, I think at this point, Kimi's like already like he was with Perez like back in 2013.
At Monaco.
I think he's fully gone. Like, I just don't like this kid anymore.
Yep.
Like, it's tricky because he has the inside line, so he does control the corner in that sense. But the fact that that corner then turns into the outside for the next part, that's when it gets like tricky. You can't just take off. Like, if it was just a right hander and it just went straight,
right,
and not turning left, then it's maybe a little bit more kind of okay,
it's my corner, I'm gonna push
that,
you.
The fact that it then goes to a left hander is where it's like, okay, you do have to really give some room, not completely run them off.
Yeah, but you can't even argue Verstappen's side. The other cars, both Perez and Raikkonen in their respective times, were actually ahead going into the corner.
Yep.
Yeah, so
they
it's
were
actually their corner.
Alongside,
you can't even if anything, like Perez was slightly ahead. You could see from the onboard and Verstappen, you could see Perez's wheel. Like, they were ahead
and
into the corner both
Kimi
times.
And with Kimi, literally the two tires literally connected at like the same points.
And then
and, like,
Perez
bashed.
And Massa did the exact same thing. They went side by side into Lecombe and managed to, you know, not run each other off the wall.
Exactly.
Okay,
they went side
maybe
by
at
side
the second
then...
part, but
but
heading
like
into
that
first corner, they were fine.
It's a bit fairer that part, I feel, because you're squeezing them off in a straight line then on the exit.
Right.
There's a lot of curbing. It's not like you're having to then take evasive action across some sleeping policemen and lose even more time.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's a bit of a shot.
I don't know how Max hasn't got a penalty yet, to be honest with you. Even Hungary was like right on the line, and that one you can give him a pass. But today, And the fact that Perez and Raikkonen both had to give positions back after what happened at Lecoum, not for me. He has to get at least like penalty points or something.
I think it's coupled,
today it was just over too much on the line.
Otherwise, he's just going to keep doing it over and over.
I think it's a shame.
I remember Magnussen 2 years ago. Do you remember that race where Magnussen was pushing his lucky, pushed Alonso onto the grass and down the Kemmel straight with the DRS open, and then he pushed Alonso off again at turn eight on the exit. Like, he got penalised for it for being a bit too aggressive, so I don't see why he's any
different. We've actually seen places, like, at that part of the circuit, seen, obviously, back in, like, 2011, wasn't it? Hamilton, like, he thought he had the move done on Kobayashi, then turned, like, in to get the racing line.
He tried to go into the racing
part
line,
That part of the track, like, if you just feel like it's your corner straight off the bat and don't give enough room, it's just a very tricky part where you shouldn't really be doing that. But I thought he didn't do himself any favours. It was a real shame. What he said afterwards, the whole deal with it thing, like it's
that's the even worse offense in my opinion. Just, you know, was a bit all apologetic, then I think people would let it slide. But and, I mean, he has no remorse.
After Hungary, they had that meeting at Germany where the drivers talked to him and like expressed their feelings in like their meeting thing. I feel like there might need to be another meeting. I think they do them every weekend. If I'm incorrect, but they'll probably do that again. I think at this point, because this time it wasn't just like one driver of Kimi being blocked. It was Kimi, then Perez later on. And just a general kind of alter his attitude after a race. So we'll see how the other drivers react to it. Certainly, F1 is a little bit split. You have, obviously, the Verstappen fans, and obviously, if you're Dutch, you're always going to support him. And then you have the other side. But as Justin said, it's interesting. It's an interesting dynamic. Like, slowly, we've been seeing, just on Twitter lately, there's just been a bit more kind of criticism of him, and more.
The thing is, I don't remember, but back to, like, Spain when he won the race, I was still coy on him. And even Cal was saying, like, oh, why don't you just like, are you happy that he was the youngest ever race winner? And I was like, well, we'll see. Just, you know, I'm not jumping on the bandwagon just yet. The thing I hate the most is fanboying. And it's like, he won the race and I was like, happy for him. But at the same time, it's like too much already. Like, I know he's only 18, he's won a race, whatever, but hang on a minute. He's still young. He could make, and then the very next race in Monaco, he had a horrible weekend.
He
crashed
had
out the race.
A terrible and weekend.
And now you're starting to see, you know, whether he's believing his own hype and he thinks he can push his luck or something like that. I don't know, but I've never, like, gone crazy about him. I always take my time with drivers, especially now. I mean, I don't have a preference. I don't follow a driver, so I see it objectively. So I judge it how I see it. And looking at Max, it's like, he's only 18. He's
got
lots of years in the sport.
That's the thing. That's also... I do agree with that. Like maybe the actual hype level is so high already. And it's like, he's still got so many years. He's still got like, what, 4 years, 3 years to get to the point where Vettel won his first championship.
Yep.
Like, he's still got so many years to mature. Like, it's like, okay, let's take this a bit more cautiously, maybe. Because I almost feel like it's getting to that territory, like, with what we do in England with our footballers and our young football players. Like, we put so much pressure and so much also, like, hype behind certain players. And then, like, you get to, like, when they get an international call-up or something, they just don't perform as well. Obviously, a very different thing, but it's like, it's almost like, as a whole, is the paddock, like, getting too engrossed in all the media hype? And it's like almost like, okay, I think we maybe need to let off just to let him do his thing. Because I think, like you said, maybe it's getting to him in his mind a little bit.
I just watched Alonso's post-race interview. He seems really, really happy with seventh place. He's absolutely chuffed. Good. He's saying a top 10 yesterday in qualifying with Jensen was incredible. And the top 10, again, within the top 10 today, well within the top 10 in race day at Spa was unthinkable months ago. So they're really happy.
Nice.
And also, Vettel has blamed Verstappen for the first corner crash as we speak.
Right. Vettel blamed Verstappen.
I'm sort of keeping an eye on the live news feed here.
Interesting.
Talking. So, Vettel blamed... I mean, at first sight, I thought it was Verstappen's fault, so maybe, I don't know, maybe I'm not the only one who thought maybe...
I think it's a racing incident.
Maybe backed out.
Personally, I mean, you know, whenever you go three wide into a corner, it gets messy, especially
like
because people might not realize they're three wide.
Like, live at the time, it was like, oh, that's close, they're going side by side. And I didn't think it was like, oh no, what's Max doing? I just thought it was like the Ferrari and the Red Bull going really close. I'm like, this is not going to end well.
Yeah.
So,
and it didn't.
Yeah, we'll have to see. It's going to be interesting to see, because you never know with FIA. They sometimes take 8 hours for these things.
Yep.
You never know. There could still be a penalty dealt out somewhere, because we've seen
I wanted
before,
to ask,
they've taken ages before.
because obviously we're talking about every single team. We haven't mentioned it, and we're now sort of focused on the Verstappen debate. But what did you think of the unsafe release with Alonso and Hülkenberg?
I thought it was perfectly fine. And Hülkenberg also said in an interview that it was just racing between them. So I think it's perfectly fine. I felt like I even felt Hülkenberg had a little bit more room to maybe give Alonso, but it was still fine. The little touch to the front wing, no harm done. I don't think it's even talk like there's nothing. Yeah. It was nice good. That McLaren released him. They're able to go side by side like that.
Right.
Yeah, like that. I agree. Yeah.
I mean, that's one of the trickiest pit exits on the calendar.
Yeah, it's very tight. So
I mean, I saw some Alonso fans and Spanish people I follow on my timeline going a bit like, why is Hülkenberg squeeze Alonso to the inside? And I'm like.
Hülkenberg was already making his way out when they released Alonso next.
There was some room on the outside, but also you got to think then he's going to go over the white line, so he's going to give himself.
If anything, McLaren should have just held the lollipop and let Hülkenberg go. If anything, because Hülkenberg was ahead the whole
time.
Right,
exactly.
So
yeah, I think it was the fact they did such a good pit stop. Yeah. They were like, release! We've done such a good one. We've gained so much time here.
Just fucking let it go.
Yeah, we've sort of come on to the kind of end of talking about the race. So in general, a pretty decent one, I guess. I think Justin said it correctly. Yeah. Like back to kind of normal 2016 standard that we've seen before. Like there's some obviously the first eight laps was a crazy thing, and then after that there were some nice moves here and there. Generally, obviously, you know, Mercedes have just gone from strength to strength this season. Rosberg really looked in a home of his own. Ricardo, you got to think that, you know, he really did the best he could, and I'm really happy that he got that, and he must be very chuffed. And Hamilton, as Tom said, literally just getting the best he could have got really today, and he's shown
mature
that maybe
drive.
Why do, he's gonna get.
I do want to say with the whole Rebel situation, you look at it, we was all sort of like a bit feeling sorry for Ricardo because he was absolutely distraught, especially when the time when Verstappen came in and he won the race and he was like, he missed out on Spain, he missed out on Monaco.
Yep.
Yeah.
But if you look at him recently, he's really putting in the shift. I think he's outraced him.
It's those shoeys, man.
Yeah, exactly. Ricardo sort of swung back right back round, you know, and
He's got the spring back in his step.
He's been there. Yeah.
He's looking a lot happier, like on social media and everything like that. Like he really enjoyed his summer break and stuff like. So I think he's just got that kind of little spring, as I said, in step back again. That little magic back again. Talking about the summer break, obviously we didn't mention it because we went straight into the race. But obviously Ocon came in to replace Haryanto. Haryanto kept as like a reserve driver. He was there that weekend in the paddock with Manor. Obviously ran out of funding, so Ocon very highly rated coming in and doing pretty decently to obviously try and match Wöhrlein, but obviously his first time, so I think he still did a pretty decent job in his first car. And as he said in an interview, I think it was, he's still got, what is it, like 8 rounds or something like that left in the season to do his catching up, so still plenty of time to grow and try and get used to that car. But that was the kind of transfer news of the season, as it were.
He'll be a keeper, I think, though. I think he's going to be around for a while.
Potentially, yeah. And then as a silly season goes, we had a few talks about, Justin mentioned it, the F1 show on Sky, talking for about half an hour about Sergio Perez potentially going to Williams or just other places. And also, obviously, that ties in with Button perhaps retiring. At this point, even I've got to, like, as annoying as it is, even I've got to say it would be pretty crazy for McLaren not to take Van Dorn.
Yep.
Just because like it'll be another year where you're not getting this great,
well, especially
GP2
after
driver in.
What Toto said. Didn't Toto Wolff say?
Yeah. Oh my god,
stirring the pot.
Yeah,
that was
exactly.
The pot.
Toto's like forcing their hand now.
Toto had his literally troll ladle out in the pot, like literally, like, oh yeah, we'll try and get him a seat if McLaren is stupid enough not to get
thing
him.
Thing is though, it's like Arav, I think I was telling you the other day. I think it was on Skype at some point yesterday, and I was saying like after qualifying, JB actually looked quite upbeat and positive, almost like he's looking for the future.
I noticed that
after
too.
That result, and even after the race today when they interviewed him live on Channel 4, because he watched Channel 4, he sounded alright. He didn't sound too down. It's almost like, I don't know, I can't tell, man. It's a bit
also at the same time though, Tom, this also could be because I had the same sort of thing back in, what was it, 2012 and 2013, where it was like also at the same time him being very chirpy could be the fact that he's sort of already maybe agreed upon within himself that maybe that's it, maybe this is his last season, and so he should try and enjoy it more. It could also be that.
Mm-hmm.
I just don't know. Obviously,
this doesn't happen with drivers too often. I've seen it twice with Michael Schumacher. It didn't really.
If Van Dorn gets
drivers like to go out on a high.
If Van Dorn gets the seat and Button's out, it's either Williams or retirement. And I feel like I just don't want him to go to Williams. I don't think it'll work out very well. And I think also with Perez in the move, maybe for Williams, it also he just brings in that. But it just all screams to me maybe sports car. A lot of people in the paddock are now saying that he probably might go to sports car racing. So yeah, that was the silly talk. What do you make of Perez to Williams, Justin? Because I know obviously you're that's your favorite driver. So what do you think maybe a potential move?
I'd rather see him go to Renault, to be totally honest. I'd rather see him go to Renault, only because Renault have a budget that Williams don't have. Sure, Renault's not very good this season, but their 2016 car is based off of their 2015 funding. And in 2015, they didn't have all the funding that they have now and stuff. So I'd rather him go to a works team. You know, Renault can really improve. They can't get any worse.
Arif, I mean, in terms of your surprise, Arif, I mean, it's the same thing. Would you rather Button go to Renault or Williams?
I don't even know. At this point, I would have to...
I mean, I know what I would pick.
I would have
by
to agree with Justin, really, because the thing is, like, even though, like, Williams will be still there next season... I just keep getting
he'll get
like,
points.
Where is this kind of push from somewhere in Williams where someone's finally going to go, okay, let's finally change the philosophy of our car because it's clearly not working here. And we keep also mucking up our strategy here and there. And as much as it's like going to be, would be like a classic sort of, oh, he's returning to his old team.
Renault would be a homecoming as well if Button wants to go to Renault. Could happen.
Yeah.
Did he really drive for Renault 2 at some point? Oh my god. Is there any team he hasn't driven for? Besides Ferrari and the low end.
Ferrari, Williams, and Red Bulls. But
he was at Williams for 1 year, then Renault another year, then BAR, which is Mercedes now.
Exactly.
He's been around.
Yeah, I just don't know. At this point, I'm sort of kind of preparing myself for not having a driver to support anymore. And
it's going
to
come, Arif.
I'm probably going to be in the same boat as Tom. And I've tried to maybe be like, no, I can support another driver, but I'm sort of also I'm sort of starting to realize with Tom that I really probably won't be supporting anyone for a few years because it takes time to figure out who you're actually supporting. Like you can say like you support a driver, but it takes a few years to be like fully behind them for every single low that they have.
Right. I started supporting Sergio Perez in 2012 when I came back to F1 after like a long hiatus, and I immediately started liking him. But it wasn't until like, you know, my real like devotion to him came at the end of that season, you know, and then he goes to McLaren and he has the struggles and stuff like that. You know, you can't just jump on the bandwagon.
Yeah, so I'm preparing myself to basically be a complete... Like, I've been sort of a neutral for the last few seasons because he hasn't been in the fight for many top positions.
Right.
But obviously, I'm still looking at where he is in the track account, so it'll be weird not to...
Yeah, but
look
phone
at
lock screen says otherwise. if that is still it.
My lock screen? No,
I don't know if it is.
I can't see my lock screen right now. I think it still is the Button thing.
The Jensen Button fastest lap.
Yeah. But that's the whole thing. I still look out for those things. So it's going to be weird, like, not looking at the live standings or anything and not looking out for my driver. I'm just going to look at the standings as it is and be like, okay, that's the order. So that's been the sort of summer talk. I don't know if there's anything else you guys want to touch on.
I want to add one more thing on the Button thing. When I think of it this way, like, where do I want Button to go? Then it's like, you know, I want him to go to the best possible team that he can go to. But when you think of it, who's going to replace Felipe Massa? When I think who would I like to see replace Felipe Massa, the first answer is Button. Even though when I ask team do I want Button to go to, the first answer is not Williams. So from Williams' point of view, I hope they get Jensen because that would be a fantastic signing. That would be great for them. From Jensen's point of view, I'm not so sure if going to Williams would be the best thing ever.
I'm not sure it's a great signing for them. I mean, let's not forget he is 36. It's not really long term, and Williams lack a bit of long term thinking, in my opinion.
Yeah,
I think it'd be a short term. I think I would only be happy with Jensen going to Williams, and even me as a Ferrari fan, I'd only be happy if he went to Williams if Williams are a top four car next year.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you just don't know that. You just can't know. I think that's a big part. Also, Jensen. Also, it's because there's a lot of talk about what McLaren doing, what Williams wanting to do. At the same time, also, it's sort of like similar situation to what he had 2 years ago or a year ago. It's also, is he happy with it? Like, is he?
Right.
I think he'll have to look at Williams and what they're offering and think, are they really going to give me a good car? Like, they say they're like, oh, look at us. You know, we're beating your current team. So, yeah, mm-hmm. of course we're good. But are they really going to be? Because I really think by the end of the season, McLaren have a good chance of starting to come back at them properly.
Next season, McLaren are going to need to watch out for, I think.
Yep. I think pretty much everyone would agree with that. Which would actually be fantastic, though. I'd love to see McLaren and Williams fighting it out. That would be a great battle to see. Yeah, yeah. But hopefully it's for decent points is the important thing.
Yeah, yeah. But, I think that's pretty much it. I think we've gone through everything in the race today. So I think that's where we're going to call it, guys. So if you have enjoyed it, hit that like button. Let us know what you thought about anything we've talked about in the podcast in the comments below. If you're new here, then subscribe to this podcast, this channel for the podcast. If you like what these guys had to say, above their names is the Twitter handle. So go follow them and check them out as well. Links in the description to their YouTube channels as well. But, that's been for the Belgium Grand Prix. After a long break, we'll be back with regular podcasts, hopefully. And at some point, Callum will stop taking so many holidays at some point. But, you know, it's a pleasure to always have you on, Justin.
My pleasure.
A lot of people will agree with me in the comments. It's great to have you on. I think a lot of people do like you on the podcast anyway, so that's not an issue if you want to come back anytime. But
Absolutely. Yeah,
that's been it, guys. Hope you guys have enjoyed it. We'll see you guys next time. Hope you enjoy the rest of your day, and we'll see you guys next time. Goodbye.